Welcome to Talk Emergency Medicine, Talk EM. John Blinsky here from the Emergency Medicine Institute. Really honored and proud to be one of their key feature speakers and to be a part of this. I'm really excited to share information and be a part of other passionate collaborative teachers. So welcome to the podcast. Now we're finishing the series on chest pain where anybody with chest pain, you want to say, who's your papa? Always keep coming back to a standardized approach. Is it pericarditis, acute coronary syndrome, pneumothorax, PE, or aneurysm? PAPPA. We just finished the section on acute coronary syndromes. Remember, ladies and gentlemen, we know this isn't the end all. It's a catalyst for your thinking. We hope to really empower you and inspire you to go, oh, I see it better. I see things more clearly. That's our whole passion and goal. I want to share with you a case study about acute coronary syndromes, and it's a true example, true life story, and it's my case study. I've been served with two certified letters and sued twice as a PA. Now, neither one of them was there a payout on my license, and I'll discuss both of them throughout the podcast and other speakers that we bring on. We'll try to get them involved in some of their medical mail cases and open the kimono, so to speak. It's very valuable to learn from other people's, not necessarily mistakes at times, sometimes mistakes, but sometimes just their shortcomings and their hardship. So I was graduated for 2 months, literally 2 months out of PA school, and I had a 56-year-old guy whose chief complaint came in and was, I have a cold. That was a complaint. So I evaluated him, and he had a cold. No risk factors, mildly hypertensive, 156 over 96, but in the ER, I don't make too much of a mildly elevated blood pressure. It's definitely not an urgency or an emergency. Said he didn't smoke, and my physical exam showed that he was wheezing. He had bilateral wheezing going on. Now, in and of itself, that makes me think reactive airway disease, and we'll talk about that more into the pulmonary section. And I have a mnemonic for that. But when I hear wheezing, I got burned when I was in PA school. Now, I created a mnemonic, and that's going to come up on our next section of people who are short of breath or have pulmonary symptoms. That mnemonic is HORID. You don't want to make a HORID mistake. HORID is either heart obstruction, reactive infection, or death from a PE pneumothorax. Again, it's a flawless mnemonic, just like PAPA. HORID. So basically, anytime I have someone with abnormal lung sounds, I have to think. You have to think. This could be cardiac. You have to. You got to think that. And he had some wheezing going on. Now, wheezing typically is an expiratory problem. They have a tough time blowing out. So wheezing typically means reactive airway disease. That's what it typically means. So I am looking at this guy going, yeah, it sounds like it's reactive airway disease. It seems like it's reactive airway disease. That makes sense to me that it's reactive airway disease. But I had to think it was his heart. Now, ladies and gentlemen, there is an infinite difference in emergency medicine, the concept between negligence and judgment. Negligence and judgment. Negligence and judgment. Negligence means you didn't think about it. Judgment means you weighed it out and went a different direction. That's a key concept of keeping out of the hands of plaintiff attorneys and getting sued. Your chart has always got to reflect that you thought about it. Okay? So as I thought that it might be his heart, I'm like, oh, this could be his heart. I don't think so because he's wheezing, but it's still possible. So I had to go, well, what's a key feature of someone who's got cardiac disease? And especially if they have wheezing in their lungs, that'd mean they have to have left heart failure. So what's a key feature of CHF? Now, the big thing is, just like the New York State heart failure classifications, you have class failure 1, 2, 3, and 4. And if you look at the exact definitions of the heart failure classifications, they're a little bit tricky, I think. It's tricky to remember. And one of the things that we do here at the Emergency Medicine Institute is just simplify things, okay? So bottom line is, class 1 heart failure is someone who can go to the mall and go watch their grandkids' soccer game. So if you have class 1 heart failure, you're doing okay. You're doing your normal ADLs without much limitation. So class 1 heart failure is you can go to watch a soccer game. Two, class 2 heart failure is you ain't going to a soccer game. You can do what you need to do around the house, but you ain't going to a soccer game, okay? You have your ADLs within your house, but you're really not going out. Class 3 heart failure is you can barely make it to the bathroom. You can barely make it to the kitchen. You can do it, but barely. You're just able to get out of bed, go pee, then you got to sit down. You can barely go and get a cup of coffee, then you got to sit down. Class 4 heart failure is you ain't even get out of bed. You can't. Every step makes you very short of breath. So class 1 heart failure is soccer game. 2, house, 3, bathroom, 4, bed. But listen, guys, they can't do it because they're short of breath. And the key caveat is anybody with CHF is going to be short of breath. They have to be, just by definition of their heart failure, the New York State heart failure classifications. So I knew that this guy who had wheezing in his lungs, I had to think, could it be cardiac, right? It can't be cardiac. So, and I knew that the big key feature of cardiac is exercise intolerance. So I remember asking him, I said, do you exercise? No, scratch it. I didn't even ask that. I said, I tried to be more subtle than that. I said, do you walk and get your mail like normal? He said, yeah, I get my mail like normal. Oh, and I'm like, I didn't really ask what, I didn't ask a question in a way I got the answer I wanted. So then he says, or I said to him, I said, can you walk the mall like normal? He said, yes. And I felt a sense of frustration from him. It's impressive how patient engagements are tattooed in your brain that have an intense outcome. Well, the last thing I said was, because I felt him getting frustrated. He just wanted a Z-Pack to go. And I finally said, do you exercise? He goes, I just walked a half an hour on a treadmill yesterday. I'm like, oh, okay, that's fine. Well, I put that on my note, walked a half an hour on my treadmill yesterday. Fine. Gave him a Preventil Neb. He cleared up well. I re-listened to him, lungs cleared, and put him on a macrolide, sent him home. Well, a couple days later, he dropped dead of a massive MI, as proven by autopsy. So I was served with a certified letter and sued for missing an acute coronary syndrome presentation. And through deposition, when they saw that I documented walk 30 minutes on a treadmill yesterday, literally in definition, the plaintiff attorney says, well, what does that mean? I said, it means he gave himself a stress test yesterday and did fine. It means that cardiac was in my mind. It means that I wasn't negligent. I was within judgment. Ladies and gentlemen, throughout the Emergency Medicine Institute and at our conferences, we will go in depth on how to protect your charts. It's a really key feature of emergency medicine. If you've ever worked on an ambulance, if you ever worked EMS, you know the first rule of being a paramedic is scene safety. So if you get on scene of a car accident, you don't rush to the victim. You got to make sure you don't get hit by a car. The worst case scenario is not that the victim in the car crash dies. That's not the worst case scenario. Worst case scenario is you get hit by a car while trying to save him and you both die. So it's always got to be protect the provider. You've got to think that way, or else you are very limited in how you can care for people down the road. And that's the same thing medical-legally. You get your butt kicked a couple times medical-legally, you could be uninsurable. You could really put yourself in a position that you can't care for patients. So medical-legally, you've got to take care of yourself, and that has to do with negligence versus judgment. Now, keep an eye on these podcasts for the upcoming series on medical malpractice defense and the art of war. We took Sun Tzu's ancient text, this book that was written 2,500 years before Christ, and used his strategies to keep us out of the hands of the plaintiff attorneys. So the bottom line is, it was dismissed. The case was dismissed because negligence was not there. It was judgment. My judgment was it wasn't cardiac because he had no exercise intolerance. And it was dropped pretty quickly. Had I not had that line in the chart, it would have been a much more difficult chart to defend. Okay. That said, in concluding this podcast, I cannot stress this enough, and I want to plant the seed. First and foremost, standardized approaches in medicine are key. Like if you interpret an EKG or chest x-ray, you better have a system because our brains are fallible. We make mistakes all the time. We come to work less than optimal, meaning that maybe we had a late night, or maybe we're sick, or maybe you have a sick kid. Maybe you're emotionally stressed because of something. Our brains aren't perfect. They're flawed. And we have to have systems, checklists, cognitive checklists. So you run through them, and therefore you don't miss anything. So if you don't have a system interpreting a chest x-ray, you're going to get burned. It is just a matter of time. If you don't have a system interpreting an EKG, you will get burned. It's just a matter of time. Chest pain. PAPA is a system. It's a pericarditis, acute coronary syndrome, pneumothorax, PE, or aneurysm. That's a system of assessment. HORID, anybody with pulmonary symptoms, HORID. That's a system of assessment. It's a flawless system. So ladies and gentlemen, watch future podcasts for our pulmonary section, how do we care for pulmonary patients, and how do we keep ourselves out of the hands of the plaintiff attorneys? John Blitzke here from Talk EM. Have an awesome day.